Wind and water are two important factors that shape the landscape of arid areas. Welcome to Digital Learning. In this video, we will delve into the action of wind and water in arid areas. Arid areas are regions that receive very little rainfall, such as deserts and semi-deserts like the Sahara Desert, the Grand Canyon, and the Namib Desert. In these areas, wind erosion is a dominant process that affects the soil and the landforms. Wind erosion is the removal and transport of soil particles by the force of wind. There are several factors that influence wind erosion in arid areas, such as soil characteristics. The size, shape, texture, and moisture content of soil particles affect how easily they can be detached and carried by wind. Generally, finer and drier particles are more susceptible to wind erosion than coarser and wetter ones. Wind speed and direction influences erosion in that the higher the wind speed, the greater the erosive power of wind. Wind direction also determines the direction of soil movement and the shape of landforms created by wind erosion. Vegetation cover. Vegetation can protect the soil from wind erosion by reducing the wind speed near the ground surface, trapping and stabilizing soil particles, and increasing the soil moisture content. Therefore, areas with sparse or no vegetation are more prone to wind erosion than areas with dense vegetation. Topography. The shape and slope of the land surface influence the wind flow and the exposure of soil to wind erosion. For example, hills and ridges can create turbulence and increase wind speed, while valleys and depressions can shelter soil from wind erosion. Wind erosion can erode deserts in different ways, such as abrasion. This is the process of wearing down rocks and landforms by the impact of sand and dust particles carried by wind. Abrasion can create smooth and polished surfaces on rocks or sculpt them into various shapes such as arches, pillars, and mushroom rocks. Attrition. This is the process of breaking down rocks and soil particles by the collision of sand and dust particles carried by wind. Attrition can reduce the size and change the shape of rocks and soil particles over time. Deflation. This is the process of removing loose and fine-grained soil particles by wind, leaving behind coarser and heavier particles. Deflation can create depressions or hollows on the land surface, or expose hard and resistant rocks that were previously buried under soil. Deflation can also transport soil particles over long distances and deposit them in other places, forming features such as sand dunes, loess deposits, and desert pavements. Wind and water are both powerful agents of erosion that can transform arid areas into diverse and dynamic landscapes. By understanding how they interact with each other and with the environment, we can appreciate the beauty and complexity of these regions. Some of the resultant features of wind erosion are ventifacts. These are rocks that have been shaped by the abrasive action of wind-blown sand particles. They have smooth and flat surfaces on the side facing the wind and may have sharp edges or facets. Ventifacts can be found in areas where loose rocks are exposed to strong and persistent winds. Mushroom blocks. These are rocks that have a mushroom-like shape with a narrow base and a broad top. They are formed when wind erosion wears down the lower part of a rock more than the upper part, creating a pedestal. The upper part may be more resistant to erosion or may be sheltered by the lower part from the wind. Mushroom blocks are also known as rock pedestals. Zeugen. These are flat-topped ridges of hard rock that run parallel to the direction of the wind. They are formed when wind erosion widens the joints or cracks in horizontal layers of rock and removes the softer rock beneath them. Zeugen can be up to 30 meters high and have steep and concave sides. Yardangs. These are elongated ridges of hard rock that lie at right angles to the direction of the wind. They are formed when wind erosion erodes alternating layers of hard and soft rock that have been tilted or folded. Yardangs can be up to 15 meters high and have smooth and rounded sides. In addition to that, let's now look at the ways in which wind transports its load. Wind transports its load in three main ways: suspension, saltation, and surface creep. Suspension occurs when very fine particles and light materials are picked up by the wind and carried within the wind. These particles can be transported over long distances, even across continents or oceans. Suspension is more common in areas where the soil is dry and loose and the wind is strong. Saltation is when sand-sized particles are lifted from the ground by eddy action. They are moved along with wind currents, but they bounce or hop along the surface as they are too heavy to remain in the air. Saltation is the most common and effective way of wind transport, as it accounts for about 50% of the total load. Surface creep happens when both heavy and light stones are dragged along the ground by wind currents. They may also be pushed by saltating particles that collide with them. Surface creep, is the slowest and least frequent way of wind transport, as it accounts for about 15% of the total load. Moving on, let's get the hang of wind deposition. This is the process of settling and accumulation of wind-transported particles, such as sand, silt, and clay in arid areas. Wind deposition can create various features, such as sand dunes. These are low ridges of sand formed by wind deposition. Sand dunes can have different shapes and sizes depending on the wind speed, direction, and sand supply. Some common types of sand dunes are barchans. Barchans are crescent-shaped mounds of sand that lie at right angles to the wind direction. They have a smooth and gentle windward slope and a steep and concave leeward slope. They form when the wind blows over an obstacle, such as a rock or a plant, and deposit sand around it. They can occur individually or in groups, and they move with the wind. Barchans are common in areas with limited sand supply and unidirectional winds. Likewise, we have safe dunes. These are ridge-shaped mounds of sand that lie parallel to the wind direction. They have two steep and convex slopes and two pointed ends. They form when the wind blows between barchan dunes and moves sand towards the sides. They can be up to 30 meters high and several kilometers long. Safe dunes are common in areas with abundant sand supply and bidirectional winds. Transverse or wake dunes, these are wave-like mounds of sand that lie at right angles to the wind direction. They have a gentle windward slope and a steep leeward slope, also known as the slip face. They form when less strong winds blow over sand from one direction and deposit it on the leeward side. They can be up to 15 meters high and several meters apart. Transverse or wake dunes are common in areas with moderate sand supply and unidirectional winds. Another feature formed by wind deposition is drass. This is the largest sand feature in a desert, with a surface resembling a plateau and a height of up to 200 meters. Drass forms when wind deposition accumulates large amounts of sand over a wide area. Drass can have barchans and sef dunes on its surface. Drass is common in areas with very abundant sand supply and variable winds. Next up is loess. This is a fertile soil with a great thickness of about 100 meters formed by wind deposition of dust from deserts. Loess forms when dust from deserts is carried by wind over long distances and deposited in wetter areas, where it is washed down by rain and compacted into layers. Loess is rich in minerals and organic matter, which makes it suitable for cultivation. Loess is common in temperate lands along river valleys or near mountain ranges. Subsequently, action of water in arid areas is the result of occasional and intense rainfall that causes flash floods and surface runoff. Water erodes, transports, and deposits large amounts of materials produced by weathering in arid areas. Water action is short-lived and intermittent, but it can have significant effects on the landscape of arid areas. Some of the resultant features of water action in arid areas are wadis. These are wide, deep, steep-sided, dry valleys in a desert. They are formed by strong surface runoff and flash floods that form rills, which are enlarged into gullies. Flash floods flow into gullies, widening and deepening them to form wadis. Wadis can have tributaries and deltas, and they can carry large amounts of sediment during floods. Wadis are common in areas with limited sand supply and unidirectional winds. Another feature is dry river valleys. These are former river channels that have been cut off from their water sources due to climatic changes or tectonic movements. They are dry most of the time, but they can be filled with water during rare rainfall events. Dry river valleys can have meanders, oxbow lakes, levees, and floodplains. They are common in areas with past pluvial periods or glacial meltwater. Mesas and buttes are also breathtaking desert features. These are flat-topped hills or mountains that are surrounded by steep cliffs. They are formed by differential erosion of horizontal layers of rock, where the harder layers resist erosion and form the caprock, while the softer layers are eroded away by water and wind. Mesas are larger than buttes, and they can have wadis or dry river valleys on their surfaces. They are common in areas with alternating layers of hard and soft rock. Next in line is playas. These are flat areas of clay, silt, or salt that are formed by the evaporation of water from temporary lakes or ponds in desert basins. Playas can have cracks or polygons on their surfaces due to desiccation. Playas can also have salt crusts or salt flats that are formed by the precipitation of minerals from saline water. Playas are common in areas with inland drainage or endorheic basins. Pediments are gently sloping surfaces of bedrock that extend from the base of a mountain range to the edge of a basin. They are formed by the erosion of mountain slopes by water and wind, which remove the loose material and expose the underlying rock. Pediments can have thin layers of sediment or soil on them, or they can be bare. Pediments are common in areas with high relief and low rainfall. As for peneplains, they are nearly flat surfaces of low relief that are formed by the long-term erosion of an uplifted landmass by water and wind. Peneplains can have residual hills or monadnocks that are remnants of the original landmass. Peneplains represent the final stage of erosion, where the land is reduced to a base level. Peneplains are rare in arid areas as they require humid conditions and long periods of time to form. Last but not least, we have inselbergs. These are isolated hills or mountains that rise abruptly from a peneplain or a pediment. They are formed by the differential erosion of a landmass by water and wind, where the harder rocks resist erosion and form the inselbergs, while the softer rocks are eroded away and form the surrounding plain. Inselbergs can have various shapes and sizes depending on the rock type and structure. Inselbergs are common in areas with ancient peneplains or pediments. Ultimately, deserts and desert features have both positive and negative significance for human activities, including deserts are rich in mineral resources such as copper, gold, diamonds, bauxite, and oil, which can be extracted and used for various purposes. Deserts have unique and diverse plants and animals that can provide food, medicine, and other benefits for humans. For example, dates, cacti, camels, and lizards are some of the products of deserts. Deserts have fertile soils such as loess that can support agriculture in some areas. Loess is a wind-deposited soil that is rich in minerals and organic matter. It is found in regions such as China, Ukraine, and the United States. Deserts have scenic and cultural attractions that can draw tourists and generate income. For example, sand dunes, rock formations, oases, ancient ruins, and nomadic tribes are some of the features that appeal to visitors. Deserts have arid conditions that can preserve historical and archaeological artifacts and remains. For example, mummies, fossils, pottery, and paintings are some of the discoveries that have been made in deserts. These can provide valuable insights into the past civilizations and cultures. However, despite the positive effects of deserts, we have a negative side. Deserts are harsh environments that pose challenges for human survival and development. For example, water scarcity, extreme temperatures, droughts, dust storms, and sandstorms are some of the hazards that affect people living in or near deserts. Besides, deserts are fragile ecosystems that can be easily damaged by human activities. For example, overgrazing, deforestation, mining, irrigation, urbanization, and pollution are some of the factors that can degrade the soil quality, reduce the biodiversity, and alter the climate of deserts. Deserts are sources of conflict and instability in some regions. For example, competition for scarce resources, such as water and land, can lead to disputes and violence among different groups of people. Moreover, some deserts are used for military training and nuclear testing, which can pose threats to peace and security. That's all for today. I hope you enjoyed this video about the action of wind and water in arid areas. Subscribe to Digital Learning for more fascinating videos.